friends, welcome back to my channel and welcome if you're new here. I have another sit down informative video for you. I have been getting a ton of questions since I transitioned over to clean eating about what if I'm not ready to quite transition over to clean eating? What should I be avoiding as far as ingredients go? It is a big transition to switch over to clean or mostly clean eating. You have to basically do a complete refrigerator, freezer, pantry clean out and get rid of the ingredients and the foods that you shouldn't be eating that aren't in their natural state, full of artificial flavors, chemicals, fat-free, sugar-free, and transitioning over into a completely new approach to eating real honey, real maple syrup, grass-fed beef. It's a big transition. It can be costly and it can also be overwhelming. But if you want to just try to eat a little bit healthier, the first step that you can do is really look at the ingredient labels of the foods that you're eating. So I'm here today to share with you some of the ingredients that you should be avoiding when looking at a food label. These are my research, my suggestions coming from me as far as ingredients that should be avoided when choosing your foods. Now, of course, if you want to eat these ingredients, that is entirely up to you. I'm just here to share with you the ingredients that are known to be harmful to the human body, ingredients that our body doesn't know what to do with, how to absorb, how to digest, or even how to process these foods because they're chemicals and they're just not foods. They're frankenfoods that our body just really doesn't know what to do with. So I'm just here today to share with you the top ingredients that you should be avoiding. This is the first step in switching over your diet from a more processed chemical-based diet to a little bit cleaner. So let's jump into those ingredients that you just shouldn't eat. On a run from my given disaster, speed away from the holy mind. Number one is artificial flavors. These are man-made synthetic ingredients. And why are these in our food? These are in our food to make it taste good, to make it taste like real food. When it is very much a processed chemical-laden food, we add artificial flavors so that it tastes like we're actually eating real food. And no means, by no means, is artificial flavoring, artificial ingredients, a real food. Artificial flavors can include up to 100 ingredients. Yes, 100 in an artificial flavor. These include synthetic chemicals, solvents, and preservatives such as BHA. Basically, artificial flavor, artificial ingredients are to help preserve food and to make it taste good, but it is literal chemicals. So you definitely want to, if at all possible, avoid foods that have artificial flavors. And on the same note as artificial flavors, let's talk about natural flavors because that is so deceptive and deceiving when it comes to the marketing of food. Did you know that natural flavors means artificial flavor? There is nothing in a natural flavor that is natural. The reason a company can put the word natural flavors on their food ingredients is because these natural flavors are chemicals that are derived from foods that grow in nature. They are still 100% chemicals. They are not natural. They are not the actual food that came from nature. They are chemicals derived from the food that was sourced from nature. So again, natural, artificial, it's exactly the same thing. Natural flavors are made from oil byproducts like soybean oil and canola oil, and over 20,000 heart attacks per year are caused from such ingredients that go into what is considered a natural flavor. Also, natural flavors, and the most disturbing piece of natural flavors is they're actually containing a trans fat. So you are adding trans fat into your body that you didn't even know that you were adding into your body. And even worse, you guys, natural flavors can still be classified on the nutrition label as 0 grams of trans fat because they are an emulsifier, not a lipid. So the FDA doesn't make companies list them as a trans fat in food, even though they 100% are an added trans fat. The consumption of artificial trans fats like natural flavors are leading causes from the disease center of heart-related diseases as well as diabetes, and not to mention several thousand, tens of thousands of heart attacks are related to eating trans fat. And sometimes you don't even know you're eating the trans fat because it's classified as natural flavor in your food. So you think it's natural, it's something that I should be eating. So what foods contain artificial flavors and natural flavors? Artificial flavors are most commonly found in cereal, candy, drink mixes, soft drinks, those things. Anything that says artificial flavor, those are their most common culprits to find that ingredient. So artificial, natural, it's all the same thing and should be avoided. Next up is aspartame, however you want to pronounce this. This is an artificial sugar. Most artificial sugars should be avoided. And let's talk about why aspartame is such a deadly artificial sweetener. It is linked to brain tumors, lymphomas, leukemia, and heart disease. Studies show that by replacing sugar with aspartame simply increased your hunger, and the subjects compensated by eating more calories. So basically, when you're eating an artificial sweetener, it tricks your brain into thinking that you're actually eating sugar. So it makes your brain want to crave more of that artificial sweetener. And aspartame, however you pronounce it, is one of those artificial sweeteners that should absolutely be avoided. Where you're going to find this commonly is in anything labeled diet, low calorie, sugar-free, or reduced sugar. Anytime that you have any of those labels on a food item, they're going to contain some sort of artificial sweetener because they still want to add sweetness to the food, but they want to take away the calories and thus the points from that food by adding in artificial sweetener. On a side note, if you see dextrose on the ingredient label, that is just another word for sugar, and that should also be avoided. It's just the chemical version of white table sugar. So if you see dextrose, steer clear. I really want to focus a little bit of time on oils. When we are using oils to cook with, what oils should we be avoiding? Number one is canola oil. Canola oil and all of the oils that I'm going to share with you are refined oils. This means that they are chemically processed oils. They are not found organically in nature. So let's talk about why you should avoid canola oil. Canola oil goes through an insane amount of processing with chemical solvents, steamers, neutralizers, de-waxers, bleach, and deodorizers before it ends up in the bottle. How crazy is that? There's bleach in refined oil. Canola oil is mostly extracted with the neurotoxin hexane. Literally, canola oil is bathed in hexane. So canola oil is extracted from rapeseed plants. That is the plant that canola oil is extracted from, but it is heavily processed and it is treated with chemicals like bleach to make it actual canola oil. Unfortunately, rapeseed oil has been known to cause heart attacks and heart-related issues in animals. So now instead of calling it rapeseed oil, they call it canola oil, but canola oil is derived from rapeseed oil. So it is actually one of the worst oils for you. Most canola oil crops in North America are GMO. They are raised to be GMO, genetically modified. They are not a true plant. They are full of genetically modified ingredients. There's also trans fat that's been known to be found in canola oil as well, but again, the FDA doesn't require that to be listed on the label as trans fat. Scary, you guys. It's scary that manufacturers and the FDA don't really tell us the truth about what is in our label, the nutrition label of the food that we are going by when we purchase and consume this food. And this is another reason that I have switched to clean eating, because clean eating, the definition of clean eating, is eating foods in their natural form. So there isn't any processing or added this or added that. And the nutritional label simply has very limited amount of ingredients, if not one ingredient. So that's why things like this can be a little bit scary. So where do you find canola oil, and what foods are canola oil most found in? Boxed mixes such as cake mixes, bakery items, desserts, dressings, sauces, frozen meals, crackers, and snack foods. So all of the processed things that we're eating, most of those have canola oil in them. Next is corn oil. So corn oil is another highly processed, chemical-ridden oil. It goes through the same process as canola oil. So there's bleach, solvents, emulsifiers, and chemicals all added into corn oil. All corn oil is made from GMO crop unless it specifically says non-GMO organic. So corn oil is equally as bad as canola oil. Corn oil has omega-6 polyunsaturated fatty acids. These are leading causes to liver and heart disease. So again, corn oil is just a chemically processed oil. Now, what is corn oil commonly found in? You're going to find corn oil in products such as chips, frozen meals, coated pretzels, so yogurt-coated pretzels, for example, cookies, sausages, snack mix, crackers, microwave popcorn, canned soups, and chilies. Those are the ingredients that you're commonly going to find corn oil. Again, you just have to read your ingredient labels. Organic is always better, but just because something says organic doesn't mean that it's not packed with terrible ingredients. So always, always read the ingredient label. Cottonseed oil is another refined cooking oil. Cottonseed oil is scary. You know where cottonseed oil comes from? It comes from the industrial cotton plants. It's not even a food. So they harvest cottonseed oil. It's a byproduct of the industrial waste from the cotton farming industry. That is scary, you guys. It is scary that cottonseed oil is a byproduct of industrial waste. Cotton is also considered the world's dirtiest crop and is 100% GMO. No way around it. It's dirty and it's GMO. And those residues of the cotton plant remain in cottonseed oil, thus making that a terrible choice as far as oils go. And what foods can we find cottonseed oil in? You can find it primarily in foods such as fries, fried foods, chips, and baked goods. Especially when you're buying fried food at a fast food restaurant, they're using these chemical laden oils because they're cheap. They're inexpensive. That's how you can buy a dollar French fry or a dollar crispy chicken sandwich, because they're using oils that are chemicals versus oils that are good quality oils like olive oil and avocado oil. So steer clear again of cottonseed oil. Next is soybean oil. Again, this is a refined cooking oil. You think healthy, it's made from soybeans. Nope. Let's talk about why soybean oil should be avoided. Unfortunately, it is one of the most unhealthiest oils out there. And the reason for that is it contributes to obesity, inflammation, cardiovascular disease, cancer, and autoimmune diseases. So stay away from this oil. It is literally the unhealthiest oil that you can put into your body. Since these soybeans are GMO, they were tested and researchers found that they contained an elevated level of glyphosate. Glyphosate, I think is how you pronounce it. What it is the active ingredients in Monsanto's Roundup. So when you're eating soybeans that aren't organic, they are loaded with GMOs and Roundup. You're basically eating a soybean that's been sprayed and coated with Roundup. This ingredient is a human carcinogen. It is related to kidney failure, autism, heart disease. These are all things that come from consuming glyphosate because it's made to kill weeds in your yard. It's not made to be consumed by the human being. And lastly, soybean oil is one of the leading causes of birth defects. So it's definitely one of the main oils that should be avoided as far as refined cooking oils go. And again, go to your avocado oil or your high quality olive oil instead. But where are you going to commonly find soybean oil so that you know where you should be avoiding it? So you're gonna find this in foods such as vegetable oil, salad dressings, crackers, cookies, baked goods, trail mix, potato chips, frozen meals, frozen desserts, buns, soups, and sauces. So all of those foods commonly contain soybean oil. So read your labels and make sure that what you're buying doesn't contain any of these refined oils. And lastly, in oils, I want to talk about partially hydrogenated oils, or otherwise known as artificial trans fats. These are oils that have been solidified with chemical processing. So things such as GMO soybean oil, cottonseed oil, they're all made from this chemical processing, and that way it allows them to be solidified, and that's what makes them this artificial trans fat. These particular trans fats are highly related to type 2 diabetes and heart disease, and is highly suggested from the CDC that you steer clear of these artificial trans fats. They have no health benefit, and again, they are not safe in any level for human beings to be consuming. So here's a little nugget of information for you. The FDA required that all food manufacturers remove partially hydrogenated oils from all foods by June of 2018. But those food manufacturers' companies all got together and petitioned the FDA and overturned that ruling. So now they can continue to use artificial trans fats or partially hydrogenated oils in their foods. So these companies were granted a special permit to continue to use these artificial trans fats in our food. Sad. It's sad that they could overturn what is the FDA says is safe for us to be eating and is healthy for us to be eating, but they are still included in several foods. And some of those foods include things such as frosting, that's a big one, baked goods, non-dairy creamers, cookies, and crackers. Again, another trans fat that is in non-dairy creamer. So now we are done with oils. There are several other oils out there on the market that aren't the best for us to consume, but these are the biggest ones that we should try to avoid and supplement with a healthier oil, again, such as avocado oil or a high quality olive oil. So next I want to talk about corn syrup. And I think it's common knowledge that corn syrup is sugar made from corn. And corn syrup in any fashion is not something that we should be eating on a regular basis. The main reason for this is corn syrup has zero nutritional value. Zero. There is no benefit in eating corn syrup. The only thing you're getting from that is added sugar and a lot of unnecessary calories. All corn syrup, unless noted as organic, is made from GMO corn, another thing that you want to avoid. So what foods can you find corn syrup in? You're going to find this in foods such as sauces, crackers, desserts, pies, and pancake syrup. In order to make pancake syrup sweet and thick, they use corn syrup. Next is caramel coloring. This is something that you're going to see in so many foods. The list is endless of foods that contain caramel coloring. Why is caramel coloring bad? Essentially, it is brown food coloring. There are four common types of caramel coloring that is going to be found in food. So caramel color E150D is the most common used in food. And on the nutrition label, you're simply going to see the words caramel color. In order to achieve this caramel color, they heat ammonia and sulfates under extremely high pressure and chemicals to create the brown food coloring or the caramel color that you see on the nutrition label noted as caramel color. This process releases a cancerous substance naturally called 4-MEI. This 4-MEI was found to cause cancer in laboratory rats. So if we're eating caramel color on a regular basis and it's causing cancer in rats, it's going to be likely to cause cancer in humans as well. So much so that in 2011, the FDA tried to ban caramel coloring to be put into foods because it's possibly contributed to cancer in humans. But instead of that passing, again, the food manufacturers petitioned and they agreed to have to list caramel color in the ingredient label in order to include it in the food. So it doesn't mean that it's any safer or better for us or we should be consuming it, but it just has to be now labeled in the ingredient list of any food that contains caramel color. And lastly, caramel coloring has zero nutritional benefit, and the only reason that food manufacturers add it to their foods is to make the appearance more aesthetically pleasing. So essentially it adds brown to foods. So for example, cola. Cola has caramel color. Regular, diet, it doesn't matter, it has caramel color so that when you pour it into a glass of ice, it has that nice cola brown color that you're expecting. Some other foods that are highly likely to contain a not so good dose of caramel coloring are going to be, of course, soft drinks, pancake syrup, coffee shop drinks, cereal, deli meat such as roast beef, and soup. So any soup that has a brown base to it probably has caramel color. So this is something that if at all possible you should try to avoid. And to do this, simply read the nutritional label. If you see any type of caramel color, try to find an alternative for that just to avoid putting something in your body that could potentially cause cancer. Next is carrageenan, and this is a huge, huge one that is found in so many foods. You guys, I was literally flabbergasted when I started looking at the nutritional labels of the diet foods that I had in my refrigerator when I thought about transitioning over to clean eating. Remember, I did a ton of research before I made that decision. So I started kind of just looking at the labels of my favorite foods, and most of them, literally most of them, had carrageenan in it. And basically what that is it's an emulsifier or an agent to add thickening to products. It helps products from separating. But the biggest thing with carrageenan is it's a huge contributor to inflammation. In fact, doctors will give it to their patients to cause inflammation for certain medical procedures or testing. So it's a big cause of inflammation. It also is a big contributor to digestive problems. Most foods have what is called a degraded carrageenan. So this is the type of carrageenan that they're adding to foods. And this is deemed to be a possible human carcinogen. So not only does it cause inflammation, it causes digestive issues, bad for your gut. It can also be a possible carcinogen in humans. That's scary, you guys. And to know that most of the foods that were in my refrigerator, freezer, and pantry had this was super scary to me. Now this is the one ingredient that is the first one that I look for and avoid at all costs. Which means this is why you'll notice a lot of you have actually been asking me, what about fat-free Ready Whip? Where's your Ready Whip, your whipped cream? Every single whipped cream that I have found that is in a can is made with carrageenan. Even the ones that are in the health food section that cost $5 or $6 a can still contain carrageenan. I have yet to find a whipped cream without making it myself with heavy whipping cream that doesn't have this. So that's why you guys haven't been seeing me eating fat-free Ready Whip or really any type of whipped cream at all. But let's talk a little bit more about some of the other foods that are commonly laden with carrageenan. So those foods are almond milk, coconut milk, soy milk, dairy-free milks in general, ice cream, deli meat, cottage cheese, and coffee creamers, and the usual suspect of whipped cream. So if I would suggest that there's one ingredient that you really try to avoid, just because it majorly can cause inflammation and digestive issues, is carrageenan. Next is flours. So any type of enriched flour or bleached flour, basically what these are is processed flours. They include synthetic vitamins and they have minerals added to them. So this is everything from your white flour, whether it's bleached or unbleached. And yes, my friends, our beloved self-rising flour falls into this category. These flours can contain up to 60 chemicals, including bleached. Even the unbleached flour that you see on your store shelves still can contain up to 60 chemicals. The processing of enriched and bleached flour destroys nutrients such as vitamin E and fiber. And regular enriched or bleached flour has zero, absolutely zero nutritional value. It's considered a dead food, so that's why they enriched flour with vitamins and minerals. These vitamins that they're adding to our enriched and bleached flour are synthetic vitamins. They're not vitamins that we should be eating. They have no nutritional value or benefit to our body. And even worse, most flour that's enriched or bleached is one of the major components to celiac disease, and the crops are sprayed with Monsanto's Roundup. So when you're eating a white or an enriched or a bleached or even a whole wheat flour, you guys are eating non-nutritionally dense flours that have Roundup in them. So there are several other flour alternatives that you should be choosing, such as nut-based flours or organic all-purpose flours. Let's chat about high fructose corn syrup. This is another one that most people commonly relate to being a bad or not good for you food. Basically, high fructose corn syrup has more sugar than regular corn syrup, and it is a sweetener derived from cornstarch. So high fructose corn syrup, you guys, is the number one contributor to increased weight gain. In addition to that, it increases your appetite, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, cancer, and dementia. So all things that we don't want to have. So high fructose corn syrup is a leading contributor to all of these diseases. High fructose corn syrup is also linked to type 2 diabetes in children, and it contains a high amount of toxic mercury. So overall, it should just be entirely avoided. So what foods are highly contained with high fructose corn syrup? So the foods that you're gonna commonly find corn syrup or high fructose corn syrup in are going to be regular soft drinks, pancake syrup, barbecue sauce, ketchup, cookies, breads, buns, pancakes, and French fries. So again, think about the foods that we classify in our mind as unhealthy. Those are the foods that we're finding a common occurrence of these types of ingredients. And if you haven't noticed, the foods that are deemed unhealthy are the foods that we're finding just tons of these ingredients that we should be avoiding in. And definitely, if at all possible, just remove high fructose corn syrup out of your diet. Along with high fructose corn syrup, there's also fructose or fructose syrup. Now you guys, this contains even more sugar than high fructose corn syrup. It also has 9 times more fructose than the average fruit. And a lot of people say don't eat fruit or limit your fruit because it has naturally occurring sugar. Well, if you're eating fructose or fructose syrup, there's 9 times more sugar in that than a piece of fruit. A piece of fruit is a clean eating staple. It's in its natural form. The sugar is naturally occurring. Where you come to high fructose corn syrup, fructose syrup, those are man-made chemically derived sweeteners. Eating a large amount of fructose or fructose syrup also leads to obesity and cardiovascular issues. Not to mention, fructose and fructose syrup are made 100% from GMO corn. And one thing to really note about fructose and fructose syrup is on the nutrition label of the food, it will not list it as high fructose corn syrup. It will list it simply as fructose or fructose syrup. So you're thinking, oh, this is a better option than high fructose corn syrup. Nope, it's a worse option. So I would avoid either fructose syrup, or high fructose corn syrup at all on any nutritional label. So where are you going to commonly find this? You are going to find this in foods such as yogurt, cereal, granola bars, and potato chips. So cereal and granola bars are pretty high in smart points because they're generally pretty sugary. And a lot of that sugar is going to come from fructose and fructose syrup. So again, another great reason to read your nutritional labels. Another sweetener to avoid is maltodextrin. So this is a heavily processed starch that is used as a thickener, a preservative, a filler, and an artificial sweetener. Maltodextrin, and a lot of you have said this, is generally known to disrupt your naturally occurring bacteria in your gut. It causes a lot of stomach issues, aka bathroom issues, and should be avoided. It is primarily used as a filler and a sweetener. It's low cost. It has no nutritional value. It's not even a real food. And it just increases the volume of food. So it makes you think that you're getting more food for less calories or less smart points. But really, it's just a processed filler. It's not even a real food. And again, it has no nutritional value. And the worst part about it is the disruption to the gut bacteria that you should be having in your body that helps keep you regular, helps keep you full, and helps just process all of the food that you're eating. It is traditionally made from GMO corn. Again, unless it is stated as organic, it's GMO. And it is also a hidden form of MSG, which we all know should be avoided. So what foods can you commonly find maltodextrin in? You're going to find these in foods such as potato chips, macaroni and cheese, frozen meals, powder drink mixes, and pudding. So those are the common foods, but I have seen maltodextrin in tons of foods. I see them a lot in diet foods, keto foods, slim fast, those types of foods, because it's going to give the sweetness that we're wanting in our food, and it's a filler, so it kind of bulks it up with no added nutritional value or calories. So it makes us feel like we're getting more bang for our buck, our calorie buck, our points buck, but the actual result of maltodextrin is a disrupted gut, lots of trips to the bathroom, and really just chemical food. And while we're on the subject of sweeteners, let's talk about sucralose. So you're gonna find sucralose in a lot of diet sugar-free foods. Most common that I see sucralose in, which is a big hit in the WW community, is things such as Jordan Skinny Syrups. If you look at the back of that, it is going to have sucralose. Splenda is made of sucralose. Essentially, sucralose is an artificial sweetener made by chlorinating sugar. Adding chlorine to sugar is how they derive sucralose. Sucralose has been linked to leukemia and blood cancer. And the worst part about it is it does little to nothing for people trying to lose weight. It actually has been known to cause weight gain. It again tries to trick our mind that we've had sugar, that we've had something sweet. But what it does is have a reverse effect where it makes us crave more sweets, where we lean more towards artificial sweeteners because they have less points or less calories or no sugar or low sugar, rather than reaching for real whole food. So things such as sucralose should absolutely be avoided. You're going to find this primarily in things such as Splenda, but you're also going to find this in foods such as chewing gum, diet sodas and diet drinks, iced tea, yogurt, pudding, and fruit cups. So there are some great sugar alternatives on the market, such as monk fruit or stevia, that are much better choices than things such as maltodextrin or sucralose or even Equal sweetened low that have aspartame or aspartame in them. So just really watch your labels for your sugar alternatives. And whenever you're buying a diet food or a sugar-free food, really, really intently read those nutritional labels. Next up is stevia. Now there is a difference between stevia and stevia extract. Which should you be buying? Should you be buying whole leaf stevia or stevia extract? Absolutely whole leaf stevia. Stevia extract should be avoided. Basically, stevia extract is a low calorie sweetener. It is not the same as whole leaf stevia. You can literally grow whole leaf stevia in your backyard, where stevia extract is a chemically processed sweetener. In order to get stevia extract, it goes through a 40-step process to extract it out of the naturally occurring stevia leaf. There are several chemicals used in stevia extract. I'm gonna look down and read these to you because I don't wanna mispronounce them, but they are chemicals such as acetone, like what we use to remove nail polish, methanol, ethanol, acetonuranil, and isopropanol. I think isopropanol is in gas. So those are the chemicals that are used to extract stevia extract from the actual leaf. Most of these are known carcinogens that can cause cancer. Plus, if you're buying stevia extract, take a good look at the label because chances are it also contains natural flavors. It may even contain erythritol and dextrose. And remember, dextrose is basically sugar. So when you're buying stevia, you wanna look for the label that says whole leaf stevia. Now, where can you find stevia extract in foods that you wanna try to avoid? The most common foods are soft drinks, coconut water, kombucha, which makes me sad, bottled tea, protein drinks, protein bars, juice, and yogurt. So really watch for stevia extract. Again, you wanna go for whole leaf stevia versus stevia extract, especially when you're buying it in the store. If you're gonna spend the money on stevia because it's not inexpensive, make sure you're getting the real deal, the whole leaf stevia, not the extract. And lastly, I wanna talk about MSG, and this is a big one. And you'll see a lot of times on windows of Chinese restaurants where it says, no MSG here, MSG doesn't live here. That's because MSG, or monoglutinate sodium, I think is how you pronounce it, is absolutely terrible for you. It is an artificial flavor enhancer. And here's the thing about MSG. Take a look at some labels in your refrigerator. And if you see yeast extract on the label, that is just another word for MSG. So yeast extract is added MSG to your food. Again, when I was cleaning out my refrigerator, my freezer, and my pantry, holy moly, I was shocked at how many foods that I was eating that had yeast extract. And I saw that and I thought, eh, what's yeast extract? Yeast, that's not bad for you. That's what they use to rise bread. No, yeast extract is MSG. So why put MSG or yeast extract in foods? There is one reason and one reason only. That is to make the food taste good and irresistible, and it chemically makes your body crave more of that food. So food manufacturers use MSG and yeast extract to make you buy more of their food. That is the sole purpose that it's put in food, is to make us crave it and want it and have to go out and spend more money on their products. MSG or yeast extract is linked to headaches, mental disorders, obesity, and depression, all of which we could avoid if we just eliminated MSG or yeast extract from our diet. Another derivative of MSG that we'll sometimes see on food labels is called hydrolyzed proteins. So if you see that on a food label, it's also MSG. So absolutely avoid MSG, hydrolyzed proteins, and yeast extract. So what foods are most common for these types of ingredients to be found in? You're going to most commonly find these in foods such as frozen meals, chips, dressings, soups, rice, and pasta mixes. So like those rice-a-ronis or the, what's it called, hamburger helper, or the other types of just dry pasta mixes that you throw together to create a meal. Those are gonna be laden with MSG, yeast extract, and hydrolyzed protein. So I would say that this is probably number two on the list of ingredients that you should try to avoid at all costs. Now that is just the tip of the iceberg, you guys, on ingredients and foods that the FDA has tried to ban from going in our food, that the food manufacturers have fought back and are now able to still put those in our foods just under different or fancier names, or names that we wouldn't think would be bad for us, like yeast extract. So it's really important to read your food labels, do your research. If you have any type of a medical condition, make sure that you know what foods cause issues with your medical condition. So if you know that you have a lot of inflammation in your joints or your body, you definitely want to stay away from foods like carrageenan that cause inflammation. So it's important to do your research, have a little bit of knowledge kind of rolling around in your head when you're at the grocery store and when you're flipping over those foods that you're buying and checking out the ingredient labels. So I hope that me sharing these ingredients that you should avoid really helps you out. And again, I shared these because they are the most common that I found in the foods that I was eating that are diet or sugar-free or fat-free. These are the most common ingredients that I saw on my nutritional labels. So I wanted to make sure that you just have the education and that little nugget of knowledge in your head for the next time that you're picking up your groceries at the grocery store. Now, I'm not saying that you shouldn't eat these. You absolutely have to eliminate these. But it's highly recommended by the FDA and the CDC that you limit or exclude these ingredients from your overall diet for all of the reasons that we mentioned in this video. But again, I understand that we only have a certain number of smart points every day. And I know that sometimes we like those sugar-free, fat-free, or diet foods, and it's okay to eat those. At best, limit those if you can't avoid them altogether. But by having a clean eating approach or a clean-ish eating approach, you kind of just automatically eliminate those things from your diet because they're not found in foods that are deemed to be clean. So again, I hope I gave you some great information today. I love sharing just all of the research and the knowledge that I've gained by looking into clean eating and kind of transitioning over to avoiding a lot of chemicals in my foods and just eating them more in their natural state. So if you're new, I'd love it if you'd stick around, hit the subscribe button and the bell so you're notified whenever a new video is uploaded. In fact, if you're an already existing subscriber, thank you so much for subscribing. Make sure your bell notification is turned on so you're notified whenever a new video is posted. I'd love it if you'd give this one a thumbs up if you enjoyed hearing about some of these scary ingredients that are in a lot of our foods. And of course, leave your comments down below. I want to know, what did I share with you today that maybe surprised you or enlightened you that you had no idea was found in some of your favorite foods? Again, thank you guys so incredibly much for watching, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye, guys.